I should be receiving about now in 4.2 mile final.
Things I'm a little hazy about. So Ben will be taking over from time to time during the commentary, and we'll be sharing it between us. Before we start our flying today though, it's necessary for me to give a safety briefing, and we've deliberately timed it. Today we have a light westerly wind expected throughout the day. That may well go round a little more southerly as the sea breeze comes in, but the chances are the wind will remain towards the west, and that will at least keep any debris from ourselves away from the... Should such an event happen, please again keep clear and allow the emergency vehicle a very safe and most enjoyable day. Taking part in the next display. This requirement, a bit of common sense is needed, I think.
Yeah, because he's doing a meet.
You know, your car's made it late.
So, diving in to start its display, the Grob G115E Tutor, being flown by Flight Lieutenant Andy Priest.
That was the head-on three-quarter loop brake, and we go shortly into some Cuban manoeuvres. A Cuban is a sort of double loop. And you'll see some mirror manoeuvres where one of them goes inverted. Direction to prevent the aircraft rolling as well. Beautiful barrel roll in formation. Barrel roll, deceptively simple to look at, but surprisingly difficult to fly accurately. And generally the maneuver, when you're teaching people aerobatics, is generally the maneuver they do least well. The one flying inverted has a totally different angle. Notice them pushing there over the top. Considerable negative G. The aeroplane well able to sustain it because of its...
But of these, 3,100 were built by Morris Motors in Cowley, the car manufacturer. And it's a testament to the simplicity of this design that a car manufacturer could go and make an aircraft like this. The joy of this aircraft is that it's an easy aircraft to fly. It's a difficult aircraft to fly well. As a result, it weeds out pilots very, very quickly. And this is essential to the job. Migrate south for the winter as they fly past in their distinctive V-shape led by dominant males. Indeed, some of these creatures have been spotted in the modern crowd wind. They'll have to be pointing slightly at each other to do so. Now cast your eyes and armors ready. And fighting! So they'll peel away August 1914 and made a tour around many of the battlefields around the Somme. There's some quite memorable sights to be seen. In front of the huge, huge craters and the war memorials. And these aircraft are rightly symbolic of those aircraft of that era, as indeed the first aircraft of the Royal Air Force to fly over were the BE2s, designed by Sir Geoffrey de Havilland.
The final from the 12th Tiger race. In the lead is Easy Tiger, ridden by Duncan Green, 2-1 favourite. Followed closely by de Havilland Boyle, ridden by Robin Russell, 14-1. Then it's I'm the Leader, ridden by Jeff Wilson of 5-2. Boxport, ridden by Peter Van Est, beautifully attired. Next up, it's Gypsy Major at 8-1. King's Speech, written by Len Bitten. And finally, last over will be Tiger Feet.
At Croydon by Rollison. Rollison's major move, of course, down to Shoreham. Bear in mind, these aeroplanes are 21-foot wingspan. Your car is probably 18 feet long. And they have all of 36 horsepower. Now your car's probably got 360 horsepower. It's very difficult doing formation flying anyway. To do formation flying in a small aeroplane with little inertia is even more difficult. And to fly an aeroplane which is probably using all of its performance all of the time means that you have very little in reserve to make up if you perhaps slip behind or need to pull forward, or if you need to in fact slow down. Beautifully slowed, bearing in mind quite gusty wind conditions today. Notice the aeroplanes literally flapping around. You saw the Tiger Moths earlier moving around. That's not the pilots moving the controls, that's the effect.
To leave the aircraft, and then the other one where they're in free fall. So there they are, outside the aircraft. The smoke is coming now. Now we're listening in now for the team coach, and he's going to give the go.
Three, set.
And they've left the aircraft into free fall at 120 miles an hour, straight down. They're now pulling their parachutes, looking around them to make sure that their canopy, that they can fly that canopy to the ground. The person below them. If they touched the parachute below, the red hot smokes on their ankle would burn that parachute. And the man below you would definitely not buy you a beer that evening. So there they are, getting into that stack, battling against possibly 20 to 30 knot winds at that altitude. Making a turn, I'll now put you over to our team coach as he talks them down.
1500 feet, guys, next turn, 180 degree right turn. Turning right, 180 degrees, turning right, now. That's 90.
at the very top of the stack are our new members. Halfway down the stack, you'll have the second years, and at the very bottom, the more experienced.
Right, 790 degrees, turn right, now.
So leading them down is Flight Sergeant Mike Maguire from Nottingham. And this is the second time he's been with the team. First time is in 2006 to 2008. He now returns to us as the team coach.
Turning left, 90 degrees onto my base leg, and turning left, now. Rolling out of my turn, now. Getting twisted into wind guard.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, I'll introduce you to them as they land, and perhaps they come from near where you. Right, leading the team down is Flight Sergeant Mike Maguire from Nottingham. Sergeant Rob Priestley from Middlesbrough. Sergeant Liam Lyons from Worcester. Officer Commanding Flight Lieutenant Chris Bailey goes out now, hand in the air, calls his team in. They're all running forward for the lineup and the salute. And as I say again, this salute is for every single person that is here today. So ladies and gentlemen, as the officer commanding salutes and invites Group Captain Johnny Stringer to actually meet the team. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the Royal Air Force Falcons.
And now a humping bump, I think, which will be pushed forwards over the top. There they go. Tremendous negative G. All right for the model. One-to-one power weight ratio, but the aeroplane doesn't. So the aeroplane will eventually have to descend, possibly by a tail slide, and he's done a hammerhead stall.
This was an aircraft that was first flown on the 20th of July 1951 by that great Hawker test pilot, Neville Duke. It was an aircraft that had its problems in its early operational life, but when they were resolved, it proved to be a truly outstanding aeroplane. When the Hunter F1 went in service 60 years ago, it was not the most effective as a fighter, one might say. Whereby the Hunter initially couldn't fire its guns at altitude without the engine surging. And also those early Hunters were far too short range, though that was a problem that it had in common with many an RAF jet fighter that followed as well. The Mark II, and indeed the later Mark V, had a different engine from the Norm being the Rolls-Royce Avon. The 2 and the 5 had the alternative power plant, the Armstrong Siddeley Sapphire, and they didn't suffer from the same engine surge problems when the guns were fired as did the early Avon-powered Marks. Especially when at Farnborough in 1958, they carried out a 22-ship loop and roll of Hunters. That's something never likely to be bettered in the modern age. Saudi Arabia, that's now part of Yemen. Not landing back here today, they'll be going to Goodwood, but they hope to be able to operate out of Shoreham tomorrow. So here come the blades into land. Not the last extra 300 action that we've got in today's programme, because we have Justin Gorman, that great local favourite, coming up in the show later on. And here come the three early war fighters, and I'm delighted to see them in the next display slot. And here, leading the three out, a genuine veteran of the Battle of Britain, Peter Vasher's Hurricane 1. In seeing this aircraft, incidentally, we remember Wing Commander Bob Foster, who was one of this aircraft's pilots during the aerial actions of 1940, who passed away only the other week, having on many occasions been able to see his former wartime mount flying. Well, I noticed the Gladiator actually turning back, and there was a particularly strong gust of wind right across the runway there that I just noticed, so no surprise there that Pete Kinsey should decide that discretion is very much the better part of valour. No need to risk these historic acts.
George and Michael is
Now downwind behind us in the Hurricane, these two aircraft remembering the Royal Air Force of 1939 and 1940.
La Fraudia, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
Spitfire to listen to the engine note, of course, of that very early Rolls-Royce Merlin fitted to the Mark 1A. The slight whistle that the aircraft emitted being very notable on that example in particular, and caused, it's been said, by the little rearview mirror above the cockpit canopy. Well, now we keep the contrasts going here at Shoreham. In front of us is the very next display item, fighting machines of an earlier generation, and here to describe them, Steve Slater.
Well, thank you, and welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Great War Display Team, recreating the sight and sound of action of flying over the Western Front between 1914 and 1918.
For King and country
and army. You'll see aeroplanes that range from the aeroplane running in from the right now over the top of the college, which is a 1914 BE-2C replica, the very first aeroplane with which the Royal Flying Corps went to war. It's also known from actually an American Warner radial engine in the front, Sopwith triplane replica, representing the... And you've got a variety of types here, of course, high up on the left side of the power line. We've got that shape of the Fokker DR1 triplane aircraft, the classic aircraft immortalised by Manfred Baron von Richthofen and the Richthofen Flying Circus. We've got three biplane SE-5A fighter aircraft. Coming in low again is the 1914 BE-2 being pursued by what we call a Bosch baby. It's actually a reproduction of the Junkers CL-1, one of the first monoplane aircraft, a trench-strafing aeroplane, which actually packed two machine guns on the nose as it heads down from left to right. And that aircraft, flown by Matthew Boddington, film replica aeroplane that was originally built in 1969 for a big old movie, carries the tail code 471 of the aeroplane flown, diving in on the tail of one of the Junkers monoplanes, one of the SE-5As. Service, and actually in the latter days of the First World War and right into the 1920s, the SE-5A aircraft were actually one of the most popular types of the early US Army Air Service. Over 150 of them actually went back to America at the end of the Great War. So we've got two SE-5As, the two Fokker triplanes, two Junkers CL-1s, the Sopwith triplane being pursued now by one of the Fokkers, actually predated the Fokker triplane design. And Tommy Sopwith and his design team actually chose that triplane shape to try and get better visibility while having the larger wing area to allow it to have a very, very good kind of rotary engine.
Thank you.
sound of the aircraft as we recreate the swirling vortex of a great war dogfight. Already cruising round again now, we've got the Junker CL-1 with one of the great war display team dedicated to this display to Don B and Peter Eger. Encourage them. They can see us. I can assure you it's very obvious.
Need to be supremely fit.
We're going now to perform a formation loop. Notice the lovely sound from the propellers. Quite a large diameter propeller, and the tip of the propeller goes supersonic. It actually generates shock waves, and that's the lovely wow wow sound you hear. Wave to them, please. This one, this is a lovely crossover. Sure, but the very first team that was ever booked for the Shoreham Airshow was the Boeing Stearman wing team. Notice the girls now are sitting now on the leading edge of the wings. They have no rear support, which they had before, of course. And you can imagine they're flying along at about 120 miles an hour there. If you can imagine putting your body out of a car at 70 miles an hour on a motorway, you imagine what the drag from
from the wind resistance is, well, these girls are sustaining even more than that. And that, in fact, is called a cockpit lady. They have one foot in front of the windscreen of the pilots. PBY-5A, Catalina.
What an absolutely tremendous sound from the two Pratt & Whitney twin Wasp radials, about 1,200 horsepower each. Powering into the air, this Catalina, operated by plain sailing, another of the... This aircraft type was crucial for the Royal Air Force during the Battle of the Atlantic in terms of bridging the so-called U-boat gap, an area of the North Atlantic in which German submarines were able to roam almost at will, supported by Focke Wulf FW-200 Condor long-range maritime aircraft. Area being out of range of existing land-based types. See the wingtip mounted floats coming down. If they don't deploy as planned, they can be wound down by hand, and that, I gather, is quite an exertion. Also, as the aircraft flew past on that pass, you might have seen the nose arc carried by the aeroplane with the name Miss Pickup. Was the name carried by a US Army Air Force Rescue Catalina, an OA-10A variant as it was known. This aircraft, a fairly late addition to the flying program here. We were to have seen this in the static display only, but unfortunately the Royal Navy Historic Flight Swordfish is unable to be with us, so the Catalina was drafted into the flight display, and I know that it's open to view while it's on the ground for a small fee, so do make your way over to the Catalina, and the crew from plain sailing will be only too happy to welcome you, and I'm sure sell you a souvenir as well. So, plain sailing's Catalina completing its sequence.
Spectacle of the aircraft, the sound of the Merlins, particularly the four Merlins of the Lancaster. At this stage, it may be that one of the fighters is Griffin powered, I'm not sure, but we'll soon find out. And also, have a look and see the size of the Lancaster's bomb bay and compare it with Sally B, the B-17, which you'll see a little later. Here comes the Battle of Britain Memorial Flight. With his beautiful long elliptical wing by clipping the wings. The clip wing Mark 16 Spitfire actually has a Packard Merlin. I beg his pardon. He has a Packard Merlin engine. That, of course, is the Merlin engine built by the General Motors Company in the United States. The Lancaster comes round there with this wonderful view of the Lancing College Chapel. So reminiscent of other wonderful air shows we've had here.
I was just testing.
As the Lancaster comes by, if we see its bomb bay, have a good look at it. Picture, if you can, a crew of seven or eight, depending on the type. Picture them flying at night to and from Germany. Think of the nearly 56,000 brave men who died in Bomber Command. Many of them Lancaster crew members. Thank you.
Lancaster was a most willing workhorse. It was my father's favourite aeroplane. Of all the aircraft he flew, this was one. He said you could put it into an orbit, as we see here, and he said you could get out of the seat and you could go to the little loo down the back. There was no co-pilot, of course. And he said you'd get back up to the front and the aeroplane would still be in the same turn. It handled like a dream. Assigned to the Air Defence of Great Britain organisation, and you might have noticed as it was flying past that the invasion stripes on that Spitfire are rather thinner than is the norm. For some reason the assets of Air Defence of Great Britain had them painted at half the normal width. And that leads very nicely into really the great centrepiece of this weekend's Shoreham display. Our commemoration of the 70th anniversary of the D-Day landings. Begin our D-Day salute with a photographic reconnaissance sortie from a PR Spitfire. In the weeks leading up to D-Day, aircraft such as this were extremely active over France.
Hello.
Thank you.
we'll hear from him in a moment. But we now turn to the activities in the lead-up to D-Day by the fighters and fighter bombers. Rolling now, a pair of P-51 Mustangs. Also a two-seat Spitfire 9.
The Allied Expeditionary Force, you are about to embark upon the great crusade toward which we have striven these many months. The eyes of the world are upon you. The hopes and prayers of liberty-loving people everywhere march with you. In company with our brave allies and brothers in arms on other fronts, you will bring about the destruction of the German war machine, the elimination of Nazi tyranny over the oppressed peoples of Europe, and security for ourselves in a free world.
My best wishes to every soldier in the Allied team. To us is given the honor of striking a blow for freedom which will live in history. And in the better days that lie ahead, men will speak with pride of our doings. We have a great and a righteous call.
One of the key aircraft types in the events of June 1944 was the Douglas C-47 Skytrain, the US Army Air Force version of the Douglas DC-3. BBC reporter Richard Dimbleby was on hand to witness the first departures.
The first aircraft that is going to leave the very front in the early hours of tomorrow morning is turning on the end of the tarmac to make its takeoff. And the spirit of light shining red and green over the heads of the dark, small figures of people on the aerodrome watching it take off. Taking off from here, we go now, the first aircraft.
So now, we switch the scene here at Shoreham to an aerodrome in northern France in the immediate run-up to D-Day. During the course of the weeks prior, have opened up against the three Allied fighters. And here goes the Luftwaffe to respond to Messerschmitt Bf 109s, played here by Hispano Bouchons.
Thank you.
number finalised? The German fighters beginning to engage the Allied attackers. This very much the sort of scene that was played out many times in the weeks and months leading up to the invasion. Operations. rest of those C-47s had the gear removed against orders so that they could be made fully versatile for use in the invasion, but not Dragomut. A winch in the forward fuselage of the C-47 was attached to arrestor gear at the rear. The C-47 would fly low over the glider and pick it up with a hook. It imposed quite a stress on the airframe if you watch footage of it happening. But Dragomut was in shore. There's still a bullet hole in the pilot's seat. Here comes the B-25 in front of us. That is the second of the two C-47s rolls out. The first one, Dragomut from Dakota Heritage, captained by John Corley. Him on the flight deck was Mark Edwards, the Aces High Aeroplane, the second of them flown by Andrew Dixon, with First Officer Bill Tollett. But here's the B-25, one of the outstanding medium bombers of the Second World War, and an aircraft that was used extensively during the Normandy campaign by the Royal Air Force. A number of B-25 squadrons being based at Dunsfold in Surrey. The B-25, of course, aircraft carrier, the USS Hornet. While the success of the Doolittle raid militarily was limited, it was a huge morale boost for the US. And it also cemented the legend of the B-25, an extremely tough airframe, one that went on to be used in all theatres of the Second World War, throughout the Pacific campaigns, in North Africa with the Army Air Force, in Europe, as I've mentioned, with the RAF. B-25s even saw service extensively in the Far East, in the Soviet Union as well. Is today on the strength of the Royal Netherlands Air Force historic flight based at Gilze Rijos as operations over Normandy. For their bravery in the operations of June 1944, a large number have been killed since the early 1990s. And indeed, for those of you who've been airshow goers for a long time and remember the Royal Netherlands Air Force Fokker F-27 displays, near aerobatic demonstrations of that twin turboprop transport, well, Jan spent some time as the Dutch F-27 display pilot. Raids that took place in the lead up to the invasion itself, and indeed continued over northern France thereafter to help smooth the passage of Allied forces across the ground. One of the outstanding American four-engined heavy bombers of the Second World War, and this now the sole flying example of its type in Europe. About to run in from our left, the much-loved Boeing B-17G Flying Fortress Sally B.
We're right down there.
of East Anglia in particular, from 1942 to 45, was 27,000 of whom belonged to the 8th Air Force. Flying, B-17 preservation is reliant on charitable donations, sponsorship, souvenir sales, and particularly the support of the volunteers and members who belong to the Sally B Supporters Club. And it's because of the B-17's illustrious wartime history that it's so important to keep it flying for future generations. Generated smoke coming from two of the engines so as to simulate the condition in which so many B-17s return to base. And we dedicate this, not only as always, to the members of the Sally B Supporters Club, but also to the late Derek Smith, who headed up B-17 Preservation sales team, who passed away not so long ago.
Beside me is Eddie Forrester, who's put a lot of money into keeping the Vulcan airborne. We all have added our little bit, but Eddie's put a lot more in than the others, and he's got very excited. He was standing with him a minute or two ago, and he said, "The tin triangle is here, and here it is, at long last." The very first Vulcan B-2 that flew, its very first test flight by Tony Blackman, who is in fact here today at Shoreham as one of our guests. Try and keep this aeroplane in the air as long as possible, and it's just had a lengthy leading edge modification carried out at Finningley at Robin Hood Airport near Doncaster. As Kevin Rubens brings the Vulcan around. Rolling. massive bomb bay was going to hold Blue Streak, you may remember. Who can ever forget Exercise Black Buck? Where the Vulcan flown by Martin Withers, who's chief pilot of the Vulcan team at the moment. Martin Withers managed to land a bomb on the Falkland Islands, closing the runway at Mount Pleasant in a brilliant effort, refueled by 16 Victor tankers.
Now.
The unique airworthy examples in Europe, and that's true of two of the types that we are about to see in this next display. And it's a routine that's going to be full of power and punch, because these were extremely meaty fighters. They're both going to be going off from them.
Thank you. 6.5.